Alrighty, so generative testing, I'm impressed you all showed up, even though you probably weren't quite sure what generative testing was about.
We're just degenerates.
Yeah. No, I remember the last presentation. You promised a follow-up. This is a follow-up.
Yeah. Ah, that's right. Yeah. So there was, I guess last year-ish, somewhere in there, I did a talk on functional testing and how, you know, if you're doing unit testing, your job is not done. You need to sort of step back and take a look at the whole system. And I had sort of a throwaway comment in there about generative testing and some of the cool things you can do with it. And there was an interesting talk, and it has finally manifested itself. So this is it. So what is generative testing? And, you know, first of all, I mean, why are we testing? So, you know, everybody says we should test our software. I mean, you know, even people in this room are saying we should, you know, like, test our websites. And in fact, I am interacting with an absolutely horrible legacy system trying to retrofit it from Oracle into a graph database. And this thing takes an hour to start up and doesn't have a test suite. So it's a bit of an adventure every day at the moment. But it's on the way to a good path, so you know, you have to hack your way through this. Testing, it's not just because that, you know, the TDD guy down the hall is going to force choke you for not having tests in your pull request. No, it's actually a little bit deeper than that. I mean, testing is sort of an adjunct to your code in a number of ways. So, first of all, I mean, the most important thing testing inspires us to do is to think more deeply about what we're writing, possibly before, possibly after, possibly when it's failing. But it's in the process, what we're trying to establish, is it correct? Does this code actually do what we want it to do? And what did we think it should do in the first place? So, you know, in some cases, trying to capture this stuff in executable form as an assumption means that if your code is violating something you thought and remembered to record, then that will surface. And also, it's possible to use this to sort of figure out what you want the interface to your program to look like. So that's one of the approaches to writing unit tests. You write things that look like the API calls you want your application to have. But in general, sort of the idea behind testing is that you're asking questions of your code that you want it to answer. And so a lot of the process of testing, if you're doing it correctly, is sort of taking that step back to think about what the answers should be and what the questions should have been in the first place. So, you know, this is something we do every day. We go to our developer down the hall and we say, hey, write me a function. And it should multiply two numbers together. And you know, this is a pretty straightforward request, but since we are doing test-driven development, you know, we need to, you know, do it right. So as we all know, well, actually you probably don't know this, but if you have encountered test-driven development zealots in the past, this is the process for how you do test-driven development. You add a test, and then this test will fail because, you know, if you started at the start, there is no program. And then you fix just enough of your code so that the test passes. And then you run the test, and then if it passes, you're happy, and you refactor the code, and you keep add more tests. And so this is your development cycle, sort of running through, just, you know, staying just ahead of the roadblocks you're introducing in front of yourself. So, I'm sure that, you know, there's no way that this process could possibly be subverted. But anyway, we're going to provide a test to our developer just to get him on his way. So here's a test for multiple patients. So this is a standard example-based unit test. Here's a couple numbers. The function looks like it should be called times. And I'm afraid that the examples are in a Lisp-like language, but it's fairly straightforward to read. You just need to move most of the left parentheses over one space and add some commas. If you like more punctuation, because most languages do in fact have more punctuation than this. So you say, okay, Dev, here is this test. Let's, you know, make it pass, do your stuff. Okay. Now, as we know, not all developers are equally motivated in their jobs.
And he has a comma.
But how does he get the Cheetos to move from the plate to his mouth?
Inhale.
Just lower your chin. Yeah, come on, obviously you're not a programmer. Come on. Okay.
Lists his belly up a little bit.
Your developer is distinctly unmotivated by this challenge you have set for him. But, you know, he says, okay, I have solved your test. Here is a passing test suite. I'm going back to sleep. And so, you know, perfect test results. And now, you have interacted with him before, so you are somewhat uncertain that this test suite actually tells the whole story, so you say, well, you know, I'm a manager, but yeah, I'm going to go look at his code just in case. And, as you can see, even if you can't read Lisp, this is code that always returns 20, and it does, in fact, satisfy the test suite. So, you're distinctly unamused by this turn of events, but it's like, okay, you know, this guy's having me on here, so we'll just add another test.
That code is perfectly good, as long as 4 times 4 is also 20.
Ah, is that 34? Oh, yes, exactly so. Exactly. It's in fact suitable for multiplying many numbers together, as long as they have 20.
Many factors of 20.
Yes. Okay, so... So you say, pass it over, and say, look, okay, we've added a test in best test-driven development practice, and look, our new test fails. Your code is not up to scratch, you bozo. And he's like, oh, come on, it's only 2 p.m. But, he fixes the code, it is now passing. And I'm sure we can guess, you know, a couple ways this code could look, because you're now starting to get this guy's number. And... yep, sure enough, you can now multiply a few more classes of numbers together, possibly without expectation of correct answers. So, okay, step back. Okay, so this is what a lot of unit tests look like. You know, you're sort of guessing some things that you think your code should return. And as long as your code is hitting those, you go, yeah, man, I have 100% test coverage, which is a very big thing at some shops. So, okay, you are going to start to put a little more thought into this. Okay, so let's test this function against itself. You know, we've got a range of stuff here. And so your dev is like, okay, got it, and here we go.
Nailed it.
Yep, sure enough. Okay, so... but for perhaps we're onto something here with this test, you know, where we're sort of, you know, flipping a couple things around. Maybe we can start to make these tests more general. Because, you know, whatever your specific case is, you can always come up with, you know, some sort of end run to work around it. So what are we going to do? So we're going to try something which should always be true. So, commutativity, sure, let's give it a shot. So we're going to actually take specific numbers out of our tests completely. Let's put some random numbers in there, and let's check to see if we multiply them back and forth, you know, if it always comes out to the same number. Okay, now this is looking like kind of a good thing. And so you pass it over to your developer, and he's like, well, okay, you know, now you're making me sit up a little bit here. And passes it back, and you know, okay, you know, now we're feeling pretty good about things. Got it. Yep. Well, it turns out that multiplication is not the only commutative operation, and so our dev has said, okay, we'll just swap in some addition here.
Well, if you do that right, you're good.
Well, that's it, yeah. So, I mean, you were hoping that you'd like add the first thing to the second y times or something like that. So it's like, okay, now this guy's getting on your nerves, man. So because you're having to think back, and you did not do that well in high school algebra, which is why you're a frickin' manager. So, okay, so let's try to come up with some things that are true of multiplication, but not of addition. And I changed that example in there we go there. So if we multiply something by 3 twice, it's going to be, I can put this extra A in there.
I think you just need something to break up between
lines. It needs to be a new line in there. Yeah, so it should be a new line right there. So these things, you know, this will fix that. And so, you know, you can code this in test form. And that first one should be a 9, actually. Sorry about that. I made up these slides rather quickly, and let's change some jellies
choice
around, because I found these bugs in them in my own test suite. And again, that first one should be a 9, but you see, once again, he has found another operation here, which is going to satisfy our new test. Yes, it turns out that if you divide something by 9, it's the same thing as dividing it by 3 twice. Okay, but however, we had another test in there. It was a commutativity test, and the two of these things together means that, in fact, we have, he cannot use division in there, because if you flop division around, so, you know, 1 divided by 9 is not the same as 9 divided by 1. So this is going to get, you're going to get some failing test cases in here. Alrighty, so he says, okay, we're going to go back to first principles here. We're just always going to return 0. Then everything's going to be equal to everything else. Okay, so this maybe is not quite the result you were hoping for. So, you know, you're going to step back and start to say, okay, let's start to look at what the properties are that we actually want our software to have. So we go back to our high school algebra. We're going to add in an identity test, you know, see what happens, you know, if we multiply by 1. And if it's going to actually be, in this case, we can see if it's going to be equal to itself. Make sure it's actually the same thing with that 1 in either position there. And that's going to make his little 0 example fail. So you can start to see the process we're iterating towards with this. So we're moving away from sort of coming up with specific examples for things that we think our code should be able to successfully do, but sort of step back a ways and say, okay, these are the properties our code should have. And so the trick here then, but you can see that by specifying these properties, we can then generate test cases which are going to sort of explore the design space. So that's our random numbers being generated in there. You know, we didn't have to come up with, you know, the thousands of tests to exercise these properties. You know, you just run your test 1,000 times and it comes up with different numbers. And if one of them fails, you know, there you go. So now you may be saying, well, this is just fuzz testing. And now, don't get me wrong, fuzz testing is actually super useful. So like if fuzzing is great to use for your network services, or, you know, an API of some sort, you're just going to generate all sorts of data, throw it out there, send garbage, send stuff which is unexpected, and, you know, maybe you'll get a buffer overflow and, you know, you can report it to some vendor's, you know, bounty line and buy yourself, you know, an extra hamburger lunch. So you don't really have to do a lot for fuzz testing. You know, you don't actually have to think about, you know, how should this system be behaving. You just have to say, now, here's some stuff, I'm going to hammer on it and see if it breaks. And quite often it will break. But the idea here is property-based testing. So you come up with a framework which is going to let you make assertions about your code. So instead of coming up with a unit test, you come up with a statement of the property. And yeah, we've got a bunch here. The first one was Quick Check. That Haskell really blazed the ground here and just is an amazing piece of software. And a lot of other people have implemented their own versions. Yes, there is even one for Java, which I might look into just enough to do it for this presentation. A later version of this presentation, but I did not. The one I've worked most with is test.check, which was formerly called Simple Check, put up by Reed Draper, I believe it was. But in general, these are just very spiffy pieces of software. They add a lot of really nice support to your process in designing this type of tests. So, and the key point for this is really that third one. So it's the shrinkage that makes these sort of frameworks really cool. So, you know, if you come up with like this, you know, 300 element vector that's been randomly generated that causes your code to fail, the frameworks will then say, okay, well, let's try removing chunks of it, let's try cutting this down so we can come up with a minimal failing case. Then that, you get the failing case back, and you get the minimal one that it was able to generate back. And based on that, you can often get very specifically honed in on, you know, what's causing this in your code. And so this has actually been used to good success in a lot of places, including in programming language development. Quite often, the first target for these tools, they're turned upon the programming language that is hosting them. And in Clojure's case, they found some bugs in the collection implementation. So, you start off with a generator. So a generator is basically a sort of a specific type of random, it creates things randomly that have particular properties. But it also does them in sort of a principled way. So, you know, it saves the seeds. They've got all the stuff there so that once you have something that fails, you can sort of work your way back from it. So, so like an example of a generator here is, make that a little bigger, is that good? Okay? Okay, so we're gonna be using test step check-in to just do a few examples. We aren't gonna get super deep into this here. This is mostly to give you a little flavor of what this looks like and some pointers on the direction. And the thing is, this stuff also applies beyond just straight program, unit test type coding. So you can use this to, for example, test web services directly. If you come up with a specification for the interfaces to your REST API, for example, you can then make test cases or test defined properties to automatically generate cases to exercise it. If you have, for example, stateful processes, there are also stateful generators that can generate like a sequence of operations that make sense in the context of your operation. So this type of thing is a bit more work, but it also lets you sort of approach your testing from a different angle. So sample is like a function, and what it does is it says it's going to take a generator as the second argument, and it's going to just give us some examples of what it does. So there we go. Okay, so what that did is it generated us a bunch of integers. And so if we run it again, we'll get a different set of integers. So the key is, you see these are all fairly small integers to start with here. If we generate more, it'll start exploring a little more. So it starts off, you see, with 0, negative 1, and 1. So like if you're writing unit tests, you always write these yourself by hand. And you're going to check those edge cases. And then you need to check 0, 1, negative 1, max, and min if you're doing integers. So so we can also do things like, so in close, you can do this thing called threading, where you sort of, we're going to treat this as a sequence, and we're going to drop the first 100 of them, and then we'll take the next 10. No, we aren't. That's because that worked. Okay. No. Sorry.
I don't want to debug.
Okay. Yeah, we'll move on from that. But regardless, the sort of key point to take away here, even though I'm not hitting it in this like little example of the console here, is that it's going to start trying more and more exotic values as it goes on. So it starts close to zero, and then pretty soon it's going to be generating stuff from all over the place. So for example, let's generate some strings.
Those are strings.
Those are, in fact, legal strings. And, you know, if you have anything with Unicode in it, you know, this is the type of thing you definitely want to be throwing at your application.
Yeah,
not much fun. And writing test cases like that by hand is not the kind of thing you really enjoy doing. So having this sort of programmatic support is useful. And, you know, you can stuff them into whatever sort of containers you like. So vec is a vector instead of just a list. And, damn, I'm not doing well tonight here. No, that's because I miswrote that in my notes. There we go. And so that's going to start generating sequences of various lengths to sort of exercise stuff. And so sort of the idea we have here is that you start by composing these generators together. So you start it from these primitives. You can always sort of find your way back through this chain of integers and strings and other low-level things that were generated. We've got a bunch here. Binaries, we can do, in fact, any. So this will do any legal. Oh, okay, there we go, that's fun. Let's see if we can see what it's doing here. okay, so we've got a vector with a sequence inside of it, we've got a vector with a sequence and a vector inside it, we got something with a Boolean down there, a map, this is a namespace closure keyword, and whatever, you know, it's generating is going to be specific to your language. So, you know, if you're writing in Scala, you're going to have things that are specific to the Scala cases. And if you're working in a language with a type system by Scala, you can get additional support there. So if you have custom types, you can also come up with your own generators, either from scratch or ones that sort of, you know, pluck together important pieces. Let's sample. So let's define our own generator here. Let's call it 5 through 9. And it's going to be a generator that chooses a number between 5 and 9. There we go. And so now, if we sample that, there we go. We get an arrangement of numbers in that range. And you know, we can do all this sort of stuff. But the idea is you can then use that to start to get your data whittled down to things that exactly fit the scenarios you're trying to test. Such that not equals whatever you just generated is 5. So now if we sample that, you can see we get a large number, we can get as many numbers as we want, and it's never going to generate 5. It's doing negative numbers and so on. So you can start to get this tuned up. Like if you have, for example, user IDs that you want to test, you know, if you have any place where a user is going to be providing input, you can cast that into the form. So we'll just try to pick a couple of interesting ones. So, but now we get into sort of the idea of properties. So like, here's let's see what it looks like when it fails here. So let's define a property. And we're gonna define a property that whatever we generate shouldn't have 23s in it. Okay, and property for all, this means that for all is sort of a universal quantifier if you've done that kind of math. But you're basically saying that for any V, that is a vector of integers, it's going to be the case that that none of these are going to be a 23. And don't worry about the wacky syntax. That's a closure, so I know this is not the presentation to sell you on the beauties of closure. Don't worry. Okay. So now we're going to use a little facility called quick check. And so what quick check does is it applies a property to your code. And this is often how you run a test suite. There's some equivalent of this. You're going to say, I'm going to run 100 iterations of the test against this property. And oh, here we go. Okay. So let's take a look at this more closely here. So this is sort of a failing result. So after a while, okay, false, it failed. Okay, this seed is the random number that it used to generate the particular test case that failed. It failed on a vector of sine 34. It was test number 35 out of the 100. And this is the actual failing case that was generated. And, there's the 23. But, you know, so if you were providing this, in this case, since we called our property no 23s, it's pretty obviously why it failed. But, like, if you sort of cast this to a more complex real-world case, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what exactly went wrong is can be hard to tease out, as of course, and you're already dealing with Java stack traces in many cases, which are no fun either. But so what it does is it actually does this shrinking algorithm where it says, okay, I'm going to back off, I'm going to look at all the generators that were put together to build this failing case, and then shrink it down. And in fact, it comes down with the vector that just has 23 in it. And so that is like one of the real super powerful things about this approach to testing. Let's see here. So, you know, we aren't going to sort of dive super deep. I think that's probably enough code This is going to be a fairly short presentation compared to some of our other ones, but just to sort of brush through the ideas here. Now, you take your primitives, you combine them with these combinators, and then you make your properties, your propositions. These are the things that you're saying are true of your code. We just saw for all and such that. So if you've ever done a mathematical proof, this is the kind of way you want to start thinking about your code. You can use let to sort of define a value that you're going to reuse a number of times. So that's, you know, for example, if you want to make sure A equals B and B equals A, sticking a let in there. You define A to be one of those generated numbers, B to the other, then you can reuse them as much as you like. So here's an example of a useful property we might look at. So this is, for example, when you're looking for this thing, you want to try to say, okay, what should always be true about this thing that I'm trying to test? So in this case here, we're going to generate two vectors, A and B, and they can have anything in them. We do not care what's in this vector, so we can stick anything in there, and if that breaks it, hey, it shouldn't have broken, because vectors should be able to hold any valid data type. And then we're going to say, okay, the count of A concatenated with B is going to be the same as the number of elements in A and the number of elements in B added together. So that's the sort of thing that you can say would always be true. And if you've been writing your own collection implementation, you know, you could definitely start raising your eyebrows if this failed. And so sort of round-tripping, so encoding and decoding type operations, this type of thing is a great way to exercise that type of function. So this one, the language is a little obscure here, but sort of in principle, you know, you take your thing, this PRNSTR enclosure turns whatever it is into a string. And it's supposed to be a string that can be read back as a closure object, which is then read back using read string. And so you should always get the thing itself back. So that's a sort of round trip type testing, which again, this is sort of one of the easy wins. You know, if you have a type of project you're working on where this is the way to, where you can think about the objects you're building in the right way, this is a great way to apply these tools. You know, idempotency. So in this case, this is saying that if we're going to generate a vector, for all vectors we generate, it should be the case that if we sort it once, it's the same as sorting it twice. Okay, actually, I just demonstrated that one, and okay, so we have kind of this, I added another example here. I think we probably won't walk through that example because it gets a little hairy, and it's probably not the best one to talk through. For my next iteration of this presentation, I'm trying to figure out what the best way to sort of what kind of system would be best to show off interactively to get the message across? I don't know. What do you guys think? What would you like to see for another iteration of this talk? Anything? Is this getting the idea across to you? Did you?
Is this a package you're using, or did you write all of this yourself? Or?
No, this is a package. So this is all in Clojure using Clojure's test.check library. And for the most part, you don't want to sort of write these up yourself if you don't have to, basically because the shrinking stuff is so useful. But one of the real sort of values here is you can work in whatever language you're comfortable with, whether that's So I mean, for example, for the Java stuff, I might not reach for JUnit Quick Check or whatever the Java library is if I were trying to test like a Java service, because if you can use this to test a program from the outside as well, you know. So anything you can script, you know, if you can script your interaction with something. So for example, there is a lovely example out there that somebody did of using Haskell to perform exactly this type of testing on a C line. So since you can interact with something via a native interface, you know, you can start exercising it. So you work in, you know, sort of two levels at once. You have the code you're testing, and then you have your testing environment you're building around it. And since this doesn't exist at runtime, it doesn't matter what you're using. It's whatever, you know, is most comfortable for you at development time. So I'm kind of thinking that maybe an example of like testing a web interface might be a good way to get this type of message across.
Right, something other than...
Something other than just these sort of
closure.
These low-level closure. Yeah, I would have done it in another language, but this is what I've been working with mostly lately, so...
So you test it on the website.
Yeah.
How does it go from the shorting? Bruce, you have to like look in the internals. Like, how does it go from the really simple things to the more complicated ones? Have you looked at like how it actually is doing
that? So in what sense?
How does it go from like 0 and minus 1 and 1 up to like 23? And
So each generator has sort of its own internal logic for the types of numbers it's going to generate. And so they're usually biased random number generators. So sometimes you'll have some hard-coded cases at the beginning. So like you always get that 0, 1, negative 1 right at the beginning there. But then it's going to keep tossing those out, but it'll then progressively just start spreading the range that it's testing. So, and you often need to think about that. For example, if you're trying to come up with two numbers and you want one to be less. So when you're generating these things, one thing you have to think about is if you're, say, filtering cases, let's say you want only even numbers. One way to do that is to say, okay, I'm going to generate a random number, and unless it's a multiple of 2, I'm going to reject it and try again. Okay, for multiples of 2, that's pretty good. You've got a 50% chance of hitting it. However, if you start chaining a bunch of these together, and you're starting getting to these more and more things that are unlikely to be generated randomly, your tests can start to get very long and running. So because you might never hit on a test case which actually is going to satisfy your preconditions, so you can actually run your test.
What about the repeatability of your random number generator?
So,
that's what you see there.
Yeah, so that's really it. So these are seeded random numbers, so the frameworks will typically track this for you. So like in our first little toy example where we were writing the random number unit tests, you know, those are not good tests. I mean, you know, they'll show us when stuff breaks, but it doesn't give us a lot of tools for reproducing it. But since this seed was used as to go through all of the different properties that went into generating this. In this case, it was pretty straightforward. It's just this gen integer. But if it's then able to use that to say, okay, I'm going to keep just backing off. So it doesn't have to regenerate any of those intermediate test cases.
I mean, would you use this in conjunction with static tests as well? Like once you see that 23 makes this fail, then would you put 23 into like your like static test
case? I would, yes. Yeah, so and that's another important point, is that this is not a replacement for traditional unit testing. What it is a way to sort of give yourself a nice initial set of unit tests. But you know, like as you normally would, if you find a regression or something, you know, you change that's broken your code, you want to put in your case, which is going to make sure that you catch that when it fails in the future, because you know that's your problem. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Short and sweet tonight. So thanks for coming out.
Good talk.